just going to give you the cake and then we're going to have Minister Crawford put the icing on it. Amen. As I was studying grace, wow, I learned so much that I don't think we realized that the gift that he gave us was so amazing. Because if we really appreciate and understood the gift that he gave us, we wouldn't beat ourselves up so much. When we fall into the plenty of sin, we wouldn't beat ourselves up so much if we really understood what grace really meant. We wouldn't beat ourselves so up so much when we sin, because he said that he forgives our sins. And we seem to keep on dwelling on it. So how can we really understand what grace means if we keep on dwelling on stuff that he forgave us for? So I'm just going to talk a little bit about grace, and then Minister Crawford is going to come and end it. whatever prompt the hurt or disappointment that you have experienced just on this week, just know that God's grace can bring you peace and healing. It's just that simple. We make things harder than what they really are. Whatever you have already encountered just on the beginning of this week, God can heal that, and he can give you peace. The all the shootings that have been going on, even the young people that have been passing away in the streets, through all that, do you know that God can still give you peace in the midst of all the tragedy that is going on? That's an awesome God that we serve. That's that grace that he allows to shadow over us in the midst of all the storms that's going on in our lives. Grace has been defined as undeserved favor, and God's grace is adequate for anything and everything that you will experience in this life. So we are undeserved. We don't even deserve this grace. That's why it is a gift. So when someone gives you a gift, what do you say?
Thank you.
And that's the only thing that God expects is just in return is thank you with a praise. Because we sure don't deserve it. He should have took that thing away a long time ago. But because of his grace and his mercy, he died upon the cross for our sins. All we have to do is just walk uprightly with him. Amen?
Amen.
In the book of Proverbs 22:11-12, it says, he that loveth pureness of heart, for the grace of his lips, the king shall be his friend. The eye of the Lord preserves knowledge, and he overthrows the word of the transgressor. That scripture is simply saying that in spite of what you already been going through this week, it takes discipline, determination, and hard work to live God's way. How many of you can agree with that? This Christian walk thing is a little difficult sometimes. It's not easy to always be disciplined and do the work of the Lord, especially when you live around unsaved people or you work around unsaved people.
Yes.
And make you want to say some things you don't want to say, do some things you don't want to do, but God still expects us to discipline and walk uprightly through his word. Amen?
Amen.
But God protects and rewards those who make the commitment to follow him. So we got rewards coming, y'all. All he wants us to do is to follow his word from A through Z. We can't allow the enemy on our jobs, our bosses, our neighbors, our unsaved children, or relatives to take us backwards. God said that if you just walk uprightly to me, I got favor over your life.
Yay!
Now it seems that the ones that are not saved, they seem sometimes they live a little bit better than us. They drive the fine cars, they live in the fancy homes, and wear the fancy clothes, and know nothing about Jesus. It seems like everything is going good for them, but God says that they may look like to us that they're going good, but their lives really don't amount to anything, because you got to have Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, to make it through this world.
Man, yes.
Amen. Grace is free and unmerited favor of God as manifested in the salvation of sinners and the bestowing of his blessing. Simply grace is kindness coming from God that we do not deserve. There is nothing we have done. It's a gift from God. There is nothing that you have done. I know sometimes we think we do things so good. We sing that song so good that God just gives us special favors and all that good stuff. There's nothing that you have done. deserve the grace of God.
Amen. Amen.
So that's why we can't judge one another.
Amen.
I don't care what title you carry. You cannot judge one another, because there's nothing that you have done that you deserve the grace of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Ooh, y'all hold on just a little bit longer. I'm almost done. Amen. The amazing thing about grace is that God does not withdraw. I like that part. God does not withdraw his grace when you fall.
Come on now.
Now, we know that some saints in church will make you look like God is withdrawing things from you for some of the sins that are committed. But God said he would not withdraw. He said that when you fall, I would gently pick you back up and put you back on the right track.
Yes, he did.
Now, how come it is, man, when we do something wrong, it seems like, man, the saints beat us up in ministry. They hear about that sin. They don't gently pick us up when it first happens.
Come on,
first they rub that thing in us. And that makes us feel like we're not worthy. But God said that I would gently pick you back up and put you back on the right track.
Yes.
So my question to you is that, why do we give so much faith into the ones that we call spiritual mothers when they didn't give you the grace of God in the first place?
Woo!
Come on, put your hands together.
My God. All right.
Yes. 84:11-12 says, for the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give you grace and glory. No good thing will be withheld from them that walk uprightly. Okay, he said that no good thing will be withheld for them that walk uprightly. So that means that your walk needs to straighten up a little bit.
Well,
we want all this thing from God. We want to do whatever the hell we want to do through the week.
Yes.
Then how come y'all don't run to him?
Come on.
All right.
Y'all run to me. Or your friends. Or your neighbor before you run to God.
Make it plain.
So that cannot be true. Like most of y'all say, yeah. But really, when you go through, who you call?
Amen. You right about it.
You
right about it.
When your marriage about to end, who you call?
Come on.
You just got fired. Who you call?
Wow. My God.
You get hurt, you get raped, or whatever. Who you call?
Come on.
Right.
When you go through trials and tribulations, who do you call?
Jesus.
You don't call God first.
Amen.
You call him second.
My God.
Come on, say, let's keep it real. You don't call on him first. Well, I should say most of the time we don't call on him first. And I know it's because you want to call somebody that you see. But he says, watching me, because I'm never asleep. I don't go by the clock. Because if you call me after 12, you might not get me.
Right.
But God said you can call me anytime.
Jesus.
But instead, sometimes we get caught up in our mess because we've been to call too many of the wrong people.
Well,
we should have called him in the first place.
Amen.
At his throne of grace, whatever help you need, whatever you need it, you can run to God no matter the situation or time on the clock. He's just waiting for you with open arms. It don't get no better than that.
Amen.
Because if you come calling me after 12, my eyes are probably not going to be open at that time. What's going on? They can't wait until the morning. But God listens to everything that you have to say.
Yes.
And his ears are not shaved about what you're telling him, no matter what it is. He said, my eyes is open. I don't care what you have. He said, I don't care what you've been through. You can still call on me. Because when you call me and tell me if the news is too bad, I'll be like, why you do that? He's not going to ask you no questions. He's just going to help you get back on the right track. See, we get so caught up in what we did wrong. Don't you know that God can take that wrong and turn it to a right?
Yes, he can.
Your most powerful speakers got a hell of a testimony.
My God.
They have been through hell and back.
Yeah.
Because God has used their past,
yes,
and brought it to the present,
yes,
and used it to help somebody else,
yes,
to what they're going through.
Amen. Amen.
So you can't always be ashamed of what you went through, but God can take that and make it into a mountain.
Amen to
he
that.
He can use that.
Amen.
But we allow the enemy in our ear to make us feel that we're not worthy.
My God.
And make us go from the front seat to the middle seat to the back seat to out the door. That's what people do. That's not God.
Amen.
Some sins seem bigger than others because the consequences are much more serious. Like a sin like when you murder someone, the consequences of that is a lot more buried than an overeating sin.
Uh-huh.
But this does not mean that because we do lesser sins, we deserve eternal life.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
All sins make us sinners.
Yes.
Don't minimize little sins or overrate big sins. Now, y'all know we hear that all the time.
Wow.
We minimize little sins and we overrate the so-called big sins.
Mm-hmm.
Boo, you sin, you have separated yourself from God.
My God.
Period.
My God.
You know, we don't get to judge the amount of the sin.
Yeah.
Amen.
Because we're good at that. That's why we pick and choose how we want to just continue to lower somebody. I can't believe she did that.
Yeah.
I just cannot believe she did that. And whatever I did, you would have called 12 people and gossip to them. So guess what? We saw we in the same sin.
Uh-huh.
Amen to that.
So why do we do that to one another?
Wow.
Why do the saints do that to one another? We're supposed to build up one another.
Yes.
When someone is hurt, we're so concerned about what they did, we can't even build them up.
Yeah.
So what really happened that thing? I know you need prayer, but what really happened?
Uh-huh.
Okay, I know you and your husband go, but what? How'd y'all get here?
Uh-huh.
We're too nosy.
Uh-huh.
And I don't even know why you want to know what's going on. You can't do nothing
about it. Amen. That's
if
it.
I told you
that's
I was in foreclosure. Are you going to help me get out of foreclosure?
No.
No, you're not. So you know what I tell people? They call me. I don't want to know what's happening. Let's just pray.
Amen.
Somebody about money. Let's just pray.
That's it.
You might need a loan. I don't want to know about that. Let's just pray.
Amen.
So sometimes you can't even handle what they're going through anyway.
Amen to
so
that.
So just take it straight to the throne.
Yes.
Amen. I'm almost done. My God. The righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between the Jew and the Gentile. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God and are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Do you believe that?
Amen.
So we cannot judge?
No, we can't.
The grace of God is a gift?
Yes, it is.
If it's offered to you, all you have to do is say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
It's just that simple. We make it seem like it's more harder than that. We make it seem like, you sure you want to accept the grace of God? No, it's not that deep. You know, we scare people.
Yeah.
They come down here sometimes and be like, you sure you ready to give up everything that you've been going right through the step? We make it as if we have never been there before.
Yeah.
Grace is a free gift.
Yeah.
Nobody in this room deserves it.
That's it.
It's offered to anyone that wants it, but no one in here deserves it. No one in here deserves it.
Amen.
I don't care how you got here by bus, car, where you are no better than the person sitting next to you.
That's it.
Sometimes when people don't look the way we want them to look, or dress the way we want them to dress, or drive the car we want them to drive, or live when we want them to live, it doesn't matter to the eyesight of God. You don't deserve a gift either in a Mercedes or a bus. You don't deserve it either. I want to put your hands together. I'm almost done. God wants you to succeed in every area of your life.
Hallelujah.
With his presence in your life, you can have it. God wants you to succeed in every area of your life. With his presence in your life, you can. You believe that?
Yes.
That God wants you to succeed?
Amen.
So when you go through, that's temporary. Because his goal for you is to succeed.
Yes.
So the next time you go through the storm, be like, oh, this is temporary.
That's it.
Because that's not God. He doesn't want me to learn something from this.
Yeah.
You got to speak to that thing. Oh, I lost my house. You know why I probably shouldn't have had it in the first place? It was too expensive. That's temporary. God wants me to succeed. He got something better for me.
Yeah.
You got to learn how to speak to those mountains.
Amen.
You know, my marriage went bad. Why shouldn't I marry him in the first place? You know, I just married him because I thought he was fine. It's mine. He wasn't God's son. But you know what? I'm going to succeed. I'm going to get through this divorce. I'm going to be okay. And I'm going to succeed. We seem to down ourselves too much. We put ourselves down too much. And I think we owe God an apology. Because we be doing stuff in our life that God didn't even direct us to do.
All right.
He don't even be knowing some of the stuff that you be doing. He be like, what they doing? I want them to succeed. I want them to prosper. I am a forgiving God. So why are they still talking about that sin that they committed a year ago? Why do they keep bringing that same sin up to the altar?
Yeah.
You must want to sin. You must like your sin that you in. Because you keep talking about it.
Mm.
Once you have asked God for forgiveness, he has wiped it out.
Thank you, Lord.
He don't bring it up no more. Now, Lord, you know what I did. You know what I did, remember? No, he said, I don't remember. I'm done with that.
Yeah.
So why do we keep weighing that burden on us? Is it for sympathy? What is it for? Because God is done with it. Amen. I'm almost done. His grace is unmerited favor. It can swing doors open of opportunities and places that you have never been before. You know, there's jobs that you can apply for and not even have the education, and you can get that job. That's how good favor is.
Right about it. Right about it.
Some of you don't believe that you got that type of favor on your life. Some of you walk into a job interview and already know, oh, I'm not going to get this job. Mm-mm, this ain't for me. You're not already spoke down to that in spirit in the first place. You got to learn how to walk up in places and be like, I wasn't going to get this job today. They said I need a master's degree, but I don't have one. But I'm going to walk in here like I got a master's, and I'm going to claim this job on today.
Yes.
That's not what we do.
Yeah.
That's not what we do. We doubt ourselves. I have started an accessory business. I'm always doing something, but they said millionaires have multiple incomes, right? So I plan to be a millionaire.
Amen.
So I started a new business, and the business was living fast, and I thought it would go. So I had all this merchandise coming in, accessory business, purses and handbags and accessories, jewelry was coming in. I'm like, okay, what am I gonna do with this? So I don't have no building. So all this stuff was in my basement. And the man came, so-called, so my husband's looking at me like, I'm tired of going downstairs, all these persons in the jury, I can't even watch TV. And so I'm like, well, I'm gonna do all this shipment. And so the young lady I work with at this salon, she said, Belle, are you still gonna start the accessory business? I said, yeah, I guess. I got a lot of this stuff at my house. And she said, well, you know what? I'm doing a makeup class, because she's a makeup artist. I'm doing a makeup class starting on Sundays from 2 to 6. And I tell you what, how about you bring the stuff up here and put it over there in the corner, because she had a shop remodel, put it over in the corner, and I know you go to church on Sundays, and I know that when you get back in town on Sundays, you usually have your radio show to do, so I tell you what, I'll sell your stuff for you. And I was like, oh, okay, thanks, Nicole. I'm just like, you know, okay, thanks, Nicole, cool. So I take my stuff up there, and she's like, okay, I'll display it. She likes to do stuff like that. So just really, let me remind you, I'm not bragging. I'm boasting on God.
Right.
And so when she set my stuff up, I said, okay, Nicole, thank you so much. I appreciate that. So she had her makeup class, and she called me while I was on the radio. And I was like, why my phone keep going on? She know I'm on the radio. What she want? She said, oh, girl, I just want you to know that I sold 14 purses today. I'm so happy. I'm like, oh, shoot, I got some money to pick up after the show. I'm getting all excited. And so then I go up there to the shop, and I said, Nicole, let's talk business. You know, I'm a business person. Let's talk numbers. Because if my purses and stuff is in this section, you know, I rent a booth. But that's another part of the building. So I said, let's talk numbers, you know, like what type of percentage, you know, that I can give you. While I'm talking, she walks out of my face. So I was just like, oh, she's not disrespectful. I'm like, I said, let's talk numbers. She said, we ain't talking no numbers, babe. Let me do this for you. I see how you give people free haircuts when they go through, and how you admit, so you never know when people are watching you.
Yes.
I see you give people free haircuts. I see how you minister to them. And she said that I want to do some stuff that you do. You can have that spot for free. She said, matter of fact, in 2 weeks, I'm going to do a girls' night so we can promote your stuff. Now, mind you, I've only been open for 3 weeks. I've sold 23 bags, and I don't know how much of jewelry. I have not advertised, and a flyer went up, advertised, or did nothing. That's favor.
Yeah.
So,